This is Craters of the Moon National Monument in southern Idaho at the north end of the Snake River Plain, looking off into the north here towards the Central Mountains of Idaho. And we've picked a spot here in the monument to look at some really exceptional volcanic features. The big mound behind me here is North Crater Cone. This is a volcanic vent, a type of volcano known as a cinder cone that erupted about 2,400 years ago. And cinder cones erupt when lava mixed with some gases form eruptions in which the lava gets thrown out of the ground. I'll actually pick up some of the material here so you can kind of see it. We can look at it a little bit more closely. But the lava gets blown out of the ground. It's kind of like froth. It's very lightweight material. It's very glassy, has lots of these holes, these gas bubbles in it. This is all the rock known as basalt, but these types of chunks of basalt, when they're this vesicular, in terms of gas bubbles, when they have these gas bubbles in them, they're called cinders. And so you can imagine this volcano erupting, throwing out just this frothy, gas-rich lava, and that material, those cinders, accumulate and pile up around the vent to form this big hill of material. This is what we call the cinder cone. So this cinder cone erupted initially with a gas-rich kind of explosive phase, but in the world of volcanoes, these are actually pretty calm volcanoes, fairly approachable from a tourist standpoint. They're not big explosive eruptions that would produce ash and be very destructive. Later in the eruption of North Crater, we had an eruption of lava. So at this point in the eruption, a lot of the gases had been released in forming the cinder cone, and the residual magma that was left behind formed a lava flow that sort of came out the bottom of the cone. And as it did so, this lava flow actually kind of carried away part of the cone. Notice I'm kind of here in this kind of embayment in the cone, but as we look over here to the north, we can see some of these reddish walls on either side of the lava flow, kind of forming like a gateway, if you will. And so what's happened here is chunks of the cinder cone have been carried out by the lava flow. And if you were to head out that way a little further, you'd see a lot of big rock pillars and chunks of this kind of reddish material that forms the actual cinder cone itself. So sort of two stages of this eruption: one, the formation of the cinder cone, and then later the lava flow that actually broke away and took apart parts of the cinder cone as it flowed off to the north here. This is a type of lava surface we call pohoihoi. You can see that it's fairly smooth. There's some big ropes running through it. And this is what basaltic lava will look like when it erupts very hot. It tends to be more fluid, and so it forms more smooth surfaces. If it becomes a little cooler and a little thicker or more viscous, then it behaves a little differently and starts to form a very jagged, rough surface that we call a'a. So we're gonna walk down the trail here. There's a couple other things to note. One is that just as we head down the trail, we head into the inner parts of the cinder cone, where it looks a little different. Instead of the black, glassy cinder particles that we saw along the trail, here we're seeing a different texture. The material's glued together a little differently. It's a different color. It's red, so it's oxidized. The iron in the rock is actually oxidized quite a bit. And this is a material called spatter. So this is when basaltic lava erupts, but it probably doesn't have quite as much gas content to it. So it's not throwing the frothy particles into the air. It's just sort of spitting out clots of lava. And as those clots of lava just hit the ground, they're still hot, and as more kind of accumulates on top of them, they sort of start to get cemented together, glued together, to form this material here. So this is spatter from one phase of the eruption when it was maybe a little bit lower in gas supply. One cool thing we can see over here is if you look right here, there is a different rock type embedded in the spatter. So we can see a much lighter color material here. And this is a pumice. This is actually a fragment of pumice. And what's interesting about this is this rock doesn't belong here. This rock has absolutely no reason to be here. But we do know that prior to the eruption of all the basalt in the Craters of the Moon and the Snake River Plain area, that this area was volcanically active with a very different type of volcano
that was erupting from the Yellowstone hotspot. So we had very explosive eruptions of a different type of lava called rhyolite. And during those eruptive phases, we had very explosive eruptions that would form these big chunks of pumice, these holes or gas bubble ridden rocks of a different composition and a lighter color. So what this xenolith, what this rock fragment is telling us, is that when this basaltic lava that formed the cinder cones was coming out of the ground, it was pulling up some of the older rocks. So it actually carried with it an older block of pumice, maybe from around 6 to 8 million years ago, when this area was volcanically active because it was sitting right over the Yellowstone hotspot. So pretty exceptional little story there. And then the final little piece of our puzzle is just a short distance down the trail here. The trail kind of gets down to this lava flow, and we're going to look at one last xenolith that was carried up by the lava as this cinder cone was erupting. We can kind of see along the trail here, now it's looking more like the typical cinder material. You actually pull blocks of this out. The material's really lightweight, dark, and kind of riddled with those holes there. So we'll head down the trail. Okay, so we're essentially descending more or less into the bowels or the guts of this cinder cone that's only been exposed because this big lava flow came out the base of it and actually tore apart part of the cinder cone. Cinder cones are structurally pretty weak. It's more or less just a pile of loose rocks, maybe barely glued together. And so it doesn't have a lot of structural strength or integrity to it. So it doesn't take much for these lava flows, which are much more dense, to actually carry away or rip apart a bit of the cinder cone when the lava flows come out the base. So we're down here along the floor where the lava flow has occurred. There's a great little block here, a boulder, if you will, that has a very different colored rock embedded in it. So we can see this rock is kind of lighter in color. The texture of it kind of reminds you a little bit of granite if you look at it. And it's closely related to granite. It's actually a rock called granulite. And we typically only see rocks like these in the lower part of the crust, way, way, way down there, like literally tens of miles below the Earth's surface. And so what this xenolith or this fragment of granulite in the basalt is telling us, is it's telling us that the plumbing system that formed these cinder cones and all these basaltic eruptions here at craters of the moon, that it was tapping a deep source, that the magma was actually coming out of a deep source deep in the crust, and as it was moving towards the surface, it was carrying pieces of the lower crust with it. So it actually, some of these rocks tore off maybe the walls of the conduit and were carried upward towards the surface with the basaltic lava flows, which is pretty remarkable. It's not often in these basaltic lava systems that you get cool xenoliths like the two we've seen here that give us some information about what the history was of this area before the eruption or what kind of rocks exist beneath the basalt itself. So again, just to wrap up, North Crater Cinder Cone in Craters of the Moon National Park, just a beautiful part of Idaho.